I am humbled and privileged to speak today to honor the memory of Iqbal Ahmed, a distinguished academic and a man of action. The combination is rare, who put himself in harm's way to pursue his ideals. Dr. Purvez Ghatpurpoy was very kind to say a lot about me. I think to speak the truth is probably one of the easiest things to do. Lying is very difficult. You have to keep thinking, what did you tell that person, and it doesn't contradict with that person. I mean, truth somehow fits together nicely. Lies don't, I mean, you get exposed. But you said that then, now you're saying this. Oh, you did, but you weren't there. You said you were not well and I saw you shopping or whatever. So actually truth is very easy. There is hadith of the Prophet. Someone came to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, I have two defects in my character. I am a thief and I am a liar. And for you, I will let go of one. Which vice should I let go of? Now, stealing is a hadith mentioned in the Quran. Truth is not. But the answer was, stop lying. So, it's actually, one just does one's job. I've been at this job for almost 10 years now. Written many judgments, but sometimes things catch the fancy of people which one maybe doesn't see as important oneself. Be that as it may, today is a day to commemorate the memory of a very distinguished son of Pakistan, Iqbal Ahmed. I never had the pleasure to meet him, but got to know him through his writings. And in a way, our paths crossed. In 1998, I had written three articles. They were a rogue trick by another name. Before I mention that, the government of the day was proposing the 15th Amendment to the Constitution, which I, as a practicing lawyer and citizen of Pakistan, was opposing, and so was many other people, including Iqbal Ahmed. So one of the articles that I wrote, I don't know how I managed to find it, was written in 1998, Jinnah's Thoughts and the 15th Constitutional Amendment. So I listed all the articles written by sort of distinguished people, and amongst them was one by Iqbal Ahmed. He too had written an article turning Islam into a liability. It was published in Dawn. So I had written three on the subject. So this is how we kind of got to know each other. I never had the pleasure to meet him. I opposed the amendment because it was, in my understanding, contrary to Sharia and the Constitution. What the government of the day wanted was to issue directives on matters of faith. So that was considered to be both contrary to settled rules of Sharia as well as contrary to the provisions of the Constitution. The 15th Amendment never passed. I don't want to take the credit. Probably the credit is due to Iqbal Ahmed and others more distinguished. But the number 15 is occupied in our Constitution, one of the few anomalies of our Constitution. We don't have the 15th Amendment in the Constitution, but there is the number 15th is taken, just like the number 9 and the number 11. So we don't have these amendments, these bills never passed. What Iqbal Ahmed knew, and what every citizen must realize, is the importance of the Constitution. The title I'm not very happy with of today's talk, and someone pointed it out, and quite rightly so. It says, Rights and Responsibilities of Pakistan's Public Institutions and the Rule of Suo Motu. Maybe could have just started with the responsibilities of Pakistan's public institutions and the role of Suo Motu. Be that as it may, the subject is somewhat academic. It requires a bird's eye view of the Constitution, and I'll travel with you and try to capture that bird's eye view. We sometimes forget the importance of primary documents. the primary document of Pakistan is the Constitution. The Constitution defines us. The Constitution inspires us. In dark times, it lights a path forward, a path that avoids confusion as well as the dangers of stumbling over the precipice. The Constitution is the foundation of Pakistan. No other single document encompasses the spirit and essence of Pakistan with greater clarity. Everyone may have some views, everyone may have even disagreement with certain provisions of the Constitution, but taken as a collective whole, that's what brings us together. The Qaid-e-Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah and the All India Muslim League secured Pakistan, which initially comprised of both East and West Pakistan. However, in less than a quarter of a century, the country was divided because the constitutional scheme was disrupted and then jettisoned. This is something which very few focus on. After the dismemberment of the country, the present constitution was unanimously adopted on the 12th of April 1973 by the National Assembly, comprising of directly elected representatives of the people of West Pakistan, the present-day Pakistan. This is very significant. That assembly had 200 members. 200 members constituted the National Assembly, and 196 approved the Constitution. Not a single vote was cast to oppose it. So it's a unanimous document with almost its 98%. Four votes were not cast, but there were no votes in opposition to the Constitution. Within the Constitution, we discover the unified vision of Pakistan. The Constitution mandates that every citizen must obey it. This is Article 5. And if any, we mostly speak about the following article, but rarely about Article 5, that every citizen has to obey it wherever he may be. He may be anywhere in the world. And every other person, a foreigner visiting Pakistan, also has to abide by the Constitution of Pakistan. And if any person abrogates, subverts, suspends, or holds in abeyance the Constitution, or attempts to do so by force or by show of force, commits the crime of high treason. This is Article 6 of the Constitution. Let us examine the respective responsibilities of public institutions, the public institutions mentioned in the Constitution, and their respective roles. The public institutions that are mentioned in the Constitution are, firstly, the President, Parliament, Federal Government, Governors, Provincial Assemblies, Provincial Governments, Council of Common Interest, National Economic Council, National Finance Commission, Auditor General of Pakistan, the Courts, Chief Election Commissioner and Election Commission, Council of Islamic Ideology, Federal and Provincial Public Service Commissions, and the respective roles and responsibilities of these institutions are all provided for in the Constitution. I will now briefly, very briefly, just run over the different bodies that I mentioned. But before I come to that, I just want to mention the objective resolution. This was the first constitutional document of Pakistan. It was a resolution which was tabled by Pakistan's first Prime Minister, Sir Liaquat Ali Khan, and passed by the Constituent Assembly in the year 1949. This assembly included many of the founders of Pakistan. The objectives resolution provided the framework to be followed by the Constituent Assembly in establishing a system of governance for the country. I'll just quote two provisions from this. Quote, wherein the state shall exercise its powers and authority through the chosen representatives of the people, wherein the principles of democracy shall be fully observed, and wherein the territories now included in or in accession with Pakistan shall form a federation. Pakistan as a federation with a parliamentary system of governance was envisaged in the resolution passed at the annual session of the All India Muslim League at Lahore in 1940. And this was the resolution passed at the park, which was then known as Manto Park. Then the Lahore resolution was dubbed by Congress as Pakistan resolution, and the name stuck. So this is interesting that Congress first dubbed the Lahore resolution as Pakistan resolution, and we now celebrate it and recognize it as the Pakistan resolution. My